Big Blue Files of the Internet, my name is Adri, and today I'm here to bring you my June wrap-up. June was Pride Month, I'm queer, I read queer books, which I do every month, but I went extra hard in the paint for June, so this is not a surprise. We know this. I did get to do a couple of cool things in June. First of all, Penguin Teen kindly invited me to host a round of Recca Reads on their official Instagram account, which was super fun. I don't think it's going to be saved forever, but it is currently saved in their highlights, which I will have linked down below. I was also honored to be included in the inaugural Pride Book Fest, which is an independent online book festival celebrating queer authors, books, readers, publishing professionals, and literacy advocates. They graciously invited me to have a one-on-one discussion with Anna Marie McLemore about how their magical realist work intersects with queerness and transness. That conversation brought me so much joy, and you can watch that along with all the other panels and events for free on the Pride Book Fest YouTube channel. Those links will also be included downstairs. Last time I checked, all the panels and events at least have auto captions turned on, and the description of each video says that transcripts and full captions are on the way. I don't know the exact timeline for that, but hopefully soon. With all that said, let's get into the books, and the first one I picked up for June was In Deeper Waters by F.T. Lukens. I buddy read this with the CB Protection Squad, and as always, we had the best time with it. I would say it's queer historical fantasy about Prince Tal, who's finally going on his coming of age tour to see his kingdom for what's really the first time. He's led a very sheltered life hidden away in the palace because his family doesn't want anyone to find out that he has dangerous magic. Tal is hungry for adventure and excitement, and no sooner does his tour begin when he's captured by pirates and held ransom in a plot to forcibly reveal his powers. Then it's up to his family and a mysterious boy named Athlin to get him back. Content warnings for references to death and massacres, allusions to contagious illness, destruction by fire, descriptions of captivity, brief allusions to depression and depressive episodes, and graphic descriptions of blood, injury, fatal wounds, and violence. I had such a great time reading this book with my friends, and I think I was able to enjoy it because I had the right expectations, which I'm going to pass on to you now, because somehow, somewhere, the pitch for this book has become gay pirates, and that's not actually true. Let me be perfectly clear, it's extremely gay, and there are definitely pirates, at least in certain parts of the story, but the two main characters are not pirates. And actually, it would be more accurate to say it's closer to a fairy tale retelling, but I can't tell you which fairy tale because that reveal is actually built into the story, but I think you can guess. So shout out to my friend who gave me a heads up about that, and I was able to readjust my expectations, and I think I enjoyed the story so much more because of it. This story for me strikes such a great balance of adventure and soft romance. It's tropey, it's magical, it's full of side quests and dangerous secrets and curses, and I think the best part is that no two sections of the story are quite the same. The adventure itself is constantly changing and overturning the audience's expectations because you think you know what the story is about, you think you know what the central conflict is, and then the story keeps proving that you actually don't. There's a constant change of scenery and stakes, and it makes reading the story that much more exciting. It keeps you on your toes. I love that discovering the real story is part of the reading process, and I think all those different moving parts not only create pieces of the journey that are distinct and engaging, but that create layers to the characters' experiences. There's also a really great parallel between Tal struggling to control his magic and Athlin struggling to conceal his unspeakable curse. They both have these parts of themselves they've been taught to hide or fear or feel ashamed of, and through this journey they're learning not only how to trust each other with those things, but also how to trust themselves. They're realizing that the parts of themselves they cannot change are not things to be feared, but rather things about themselves that they need to understand. Magic is not an inherently bad thing because its power lies in how they choose to use it, and choices themselves have just as much power as magic. Like I said, it's a really fun, adventurous, queer fantasy story that's incredibly fast-paced. It absolutely flies by, and even though a ton of things are happening and the story has depth to it, it never feels daunting to process. My one critique is that I wanted a little bit more from the world building because the dynamics and politics of the surrounding kingdoms are somewhat of a plot point, but they never truly felt defined, at least for me. But I still love this, and I would happily read so many more books by F.T. Lukens. I gave this 4 stars. As soon as I finished that, we jumped right into the Queer Lit Readathon, and for that I read Ace, Meet Cute Diary, Boys Run the Riot, Hola Papi, Given Volume 5, and Blue Flag Volume 7, and I did a separate wrap-up video for that, which you will find linked in the description box. Then I picked up my arc of Rise to the Sun by Leah Johnson. This is coming out soon on July 6th, and this review copy was kindly sent to me by the author herself. It's a queer contemporary story about two black girls named Olivia and Tony who meet at a summer music festival where they're hoping to change their lives. Olivia is not the best at relationships, friendships, and she is determined to make this a special best friend weekend with no romantic distractions, and she also wants to win a brand new car by completing the festival's infamous scavenger hunt. Tony is a Farmland Festival veteran, and she is using this trip as a chance to figure out if she wants to go to college in the fall or follow in her late father's footsteps and pursue music. There's actually a contest for amateur musicians to get a spot on the final stage with all the headliner bands, but there has to be two contestants per act, so Olivia offers to help Tony enter the contest if Tony helps her with the scavenger hunt. Content warnings for references to mass shootings and gun violence, loss of a parent and grief, trauma, anxiety, PTSD, and panic attacks, asthma attacks, and some exploration of public slut-shaming and online harassment. This is a fundamentally different book from You Should See Me in a Crown, but it still feels incredibly on-brand for Leah Johnson in the way it blends romance with an exploration of complex topics. While I wouldn't call Rise to the Sun a rom-com, it definitely does have a strong romantic subplot, and the story itself is more focused on self-discovery, healing, and learning to be unafraid despite difficult circumstances. With the backdrop of this summer music festival, the story is able to capture that air of electricity and excitement, but there's definitely so much more happening beneath the surface. Above everything, my favorite thing about this story is that it centers two queer Black girls who are deeply flawed and imperfect, and while their journey is one of learning and growing, it's so refreshing that the story allows them to be flawed and make mistakes. The story understands that there are so many reasons why Black girls specifically don't allow themselves to experience joy, how they're expected to meet these unspoken and unreasonable standards of behavior in order to be considered deserving of that joy, which only keeps it even further out of reach. The relationship between Tony and Olivia shows readers that you don't need to be perfect in order to be worthy of love, and that love, whether it's romantic, platonic, or self-love, is not something that you only get to have once you stop making mistakes, because you're never gonna get to that point. This is a story that shows young readers that they deserve the kind of love that is full and complicated, the kind of love where they are seen in their totality and not just for the parts of themselves that are smallest and easiest to process. As I mentioned in the content warnings, the story also takes a realistic look at gun violence, especially in the US, and I'm glad it opens that conversation because especially when you're marginalized and you're in any kind of massively populated space, sadly, that kind of threat is never far from your consciousness. And coupled with the passing of Tony's father, it kind of goes back to that question of learning to be unafraid and trying to figure out how you pursue joy and experience joy, knowing that joy is indefinite and precious. I love that this story also captures the energy of live music, and music definitely comes up a lot as a metaphor, especially as Olivia and Tony start falling for each other, but even though it's kind of cliche to compare romance to music, Leah Johnson makes it feel so powerful and earnest and fresh. There's so much more I could say, but I think this book is so clearly written from a place of love. It's a love letter to queer Black girls that says you are worthy of the time it takes to figure yourself out, and you deserve grace when it comes to not knowing. You are allowed to be imperfect. You deserve happiness for the sake of happiness. My main critique, if you can even call it that, is that the condensed, accelerated timeline both works for the story and against the story in some ways. It's effective because it really ups the pace and the tension, and the characters have to make the absolute most out of these 3 days, but on the flip side, it can make things feel a little bit rushed at times. But I still love this book, I love Leah Johnson, I feel such a debt of gratitude for her work and her voice, and I cannot wait to see what she writes next. I gave this 4 stars. Then after making my recent video about queer books for young readers, I was really excited to pick up Too Bright to See by Kyle Lukoff. Kyle Lukoff is a Stonewall award-winning trans author, and this book is his debut middle grade story about a kid named Bug whose uncle has recently passed away, and Bug's best friend Moira wants to spend this last summer before middle school learning about boys and clothes and makeup, but Bug feels incredibly disconnected from those things. As Bug continues to work through grief and possibly growing apart from a childhood best friend, the question of whether a ghost is haunting Bug's old Vermont house becomes far more pressing and interesting, and in the process of trying to figure out what this ghost wants, it becomes clear that Bug is trans. Content warnings for explorations of death and grief, mentions of terminal illness, descriptions of gender dysphoria, and brief mentions of blood. This book is so incredibly good, and it made me so soft because it's such a tender and thoughtful exploration of self-discovery and claiming queerness. I love that this trans story is genre, and I think the connection between ghosts and transness is brilliant, especially this idea of being haunted, specifically being haunted by the version of yourself that you can't even name or imagine becoming. coming yet. There's also something to be said about the parallel of people in Bug's life needing to be convinced that ghosts exist, and also needing to be convinced that Bug's transness exists. The ghost in this story can't be seen or sensed by everyone around them. It takes someone attuned to the supernatural to be able to see the signs. And again, that parallels with how Bug sees a version of himself and a way of living for himself that no one else sees. It's also such a beautiful testament to how we are guided and held by our queer ancestors, and in Bug's case, it's in a literal sense. This ghost has the language and the understanding of transness that Bug hasn't been able to learn or articulate up until this point, so this haunting isn't to scare Bug, but actually to affirm Bug in his transness. Another really important detail is that the story never villainizes femininity or feminine modes of expression, which is a trap that most older trans stories often fall into. There's this idea that coming into your gender means you have to reject or resent certain things about your old gender, to phrase it in a very reductive way, and it actually contributes to a larger myth of transness that is antiquated, narrow, and extremely inaccurate. Feminine and masculine are not mutually exclusive concepts. They don't exist in separate spaces that never overlap or touch. That's not how any of this works. And I really appreciate the distinction of Bug realizing, these things are just not for me, as opposed to, I cannot like these things because I am trans. Another major part of the story that is rarely discussed is how Bug's gender dysphoria and gender confusion manifests as emotional distance. Bug finds it really hard to connect with Moira, not just because their interests are diverging, but because he doesn't feel like he can truly be himself when they're together, which makes it harder for him to connect to Moira and puts a strain on their friendship. A similar thing is happening with Bug's mom, where they're both processing their grief and sadness, but there's still a chasm between them that deprives them of the joy and ease they used to have together because there's a part of Bug that's being kept under lock and key. Once that puzzle piece finally falls into place and Bug realizes who he truly is, that opens him up to the possibility of giving love to and receiving love from the people around him because he finally understands that their love is not conditionally given based on something that he's not. We don't talk enough about that aspect of coming out and how affirming someone's gender and supporting them actually opens the door for healthier, stronger, and more honest relationships. There are simply too many good things for me to say about this book. It's creepy and spooky, but not to the point of being inappropriate for the target audience. It's heartfelt, thoughtful, and deeply emotional. It struck me so profoundly in ways I don't think I can fully express, but I can say that I gave it 5 stars. After that, for the Queer Blackathon, I picked up my arc of The Taking of Jake Livingston by Ryan Douglas. Ryan Douglas is a queer black author, and this is their debut novel coming out on July 13th from Penguin Teen. It's a dark, queer, paranormal thriller about a boy named Jake who can see the physical incarnations of ghosts and spirits. But everything he knows about the supernatural is called into question when he is violently introduced to a spirit named Sawyer, who shot and killed 6 kids at his high school before taking his own life. And now he has a plan for further vengeance and destruction that somehow involves Jake. Content warnings for some graphic images of death, injury, blood, gore, and violence, references to suicide ideation and suicide attempts, mentions of child abuse, domestic abuse, and rape, some references to racism, bullying, and homophobia, and explorations of mass shootings and gun violence. Make no mistake, this is a dark, challenging, fast-paced paranormal thriller that will definitely shock you, and where it shines most for me is in its commentary about how it feels to have your identity violently stripped away from you in both a symbolic and literal sense. The possession story arc also explores the forcible colonization of the body, again very literally, and how the goal of the colonizer is to weaponize the colonized against each other and get us to finish the colonizer's work. And because Jake, as a medium, is constantly surrounded by death, dying, and ghosts, the story also speaks to how black communities specifically are not afforded the luxury of healing from trauma, both personal and generational, because how can you heal from a wound that never closes? All too often we collectively move on from traumatic events like school shootings because they fade from public consciousness, but for Jake, who has to watch spirits constantly looping through their own death, that's all he ever sees, and he doesn't even get the option to forget. Especially for a supernatural YA horror story, this book definitely gets extremely dark and graphic, and there's a constant sense of danger and tension. I think it's really effective because it makes the stakes for the characters feel life or death, and it makes you feel like every action has a real and heavy consequence. All that said, I did struggle with the story a bit, and I didn't love that it was split between Jake's POV and then also the diary entries of Sawyer, the mass shooter, because I didn't feel like that really added anything to the book. I want to be perfectly clear, I don't think the author was trying to romanticize or justify Sawyer's actions in any way, but I feel like the diary entries only further perpetuate this lone wolf stereotype of young white men from broken families with unaddressed mental health issues and trauma becoming murderous and violent. So I do wish that was pushed a little bit more, and honestly, I felt like some of the content in the diary entries was borderline gratuitous, but again, I realize that's just my take. My bigger issue with the story was how disconnected I felt from Jake as a narrator and a protagonist, and I'm not giving you any of that, like, unrelatable character BS. I don't mean his background, his identity, his race. I think all of those were really well explored, just that he is literally disconnected from everything and everyone around him. And again, to be clear, I think he's a strong character and I really appreciate his character development because he definitely grows and changes significantly throughout the story, and it's really satisfying to see where he ends up. But besides the fact that he can see ghosts and he's gay, even after having read the entire book, I still have no sense of who he is. The issues he's struggling with on a personal level don't truly come to light or get addressed until after he's dealt with the whole evil spirit possession thing, which on the one hand makes sense, but also left me feeling like it was a big missed opportunity to better integrate those conflicts and character dynamics to even further intensify the stakes. If you want even more explanation, I will link all of my written reviews for my review books this month down below, because I really don't want to spend any more life minutes picking apart a book by a queer Black debut author that does ask really important questions and uses conventions of the genre to tremendous effect. I also fully recognize that this book was not written for me in so many ways, and so my opinion is not the most important one. Yes, I wish the character depth and relationship dynamics didn't feel so much like an afterthought, but I still couldn't put this one down, and I'm definitely willing to see what Ryan Douglas writes next. I gave this 3 stars. And the last novel I read was my Patreon selection for June, and that was Confessions of the Fox by Jordi Rosenberg. This is a backlist book. It's a truly unique blend of queer historical fiction meets metafiction meets academia. It's a very niche kind of story that I already know is not going to resonate with every kind of reader, but it's also fascinating. It's about this real-life, legendary 18th century thief named Jack Shepherd who was queer and trans. The story follows a trans professor named Dr. Voth who has dedicated his life to studying Jack Shepherd and everything about him, and he stumbles across this unmarked, unofficial manuscript of sorts called Confessions of the Fox. So you as the reader are actually reading that manuscript with Dr. Voth's annotations, and as Dr. Voth is trying to authenticate this manuscript, he realizes that he is not the only one who is desperate to get Jack's story, and it becomes clear that his fate and Jack's fate are much more closely entwined than he thinks. Content warnings for references to parental abandonment, descriptions of indentured servitude, physical assault, injury, and graphic descriptions of blood and surgery, misgendering, racism, mentions of anxiety and compulsive tendencies, and references to contagious disease. I don't know how much I'm going to say about this because this book is so far above my pay grade. I am nowhere near intelligent enough or well-versed enough in academia to truly break it down in the way it deserves, but I can definitely say it is good as heck. The metafiction aspect I actually really like because it brings a sense of immediacy and tangibility to the text, and it makes you feel like you as the reader are discovering this document in real time through the reading process. And while I didn't super care about the professor's tangents about his personal life, the footnotes are really cool in the sense that every text and resource cited is an actual document that exists. Like I said, Jack Shepherd is a real historical figure, and not only is the professor in this story a trans professor, but the author is also a trans professor as well, so every layer of the metafiction lends this feeling of, could this be real? Am I really reading a long-lost manuscript that the gatekeepers of academia don't want me to see? And what I really appreciate about this story and this manuscript is that it's so anti-everything, anti-authority, anti-colonialist, anti-heterosexist, anti-capitalist, anti-police. Name any systemic power that disenfranchises people, and this story is challenging it just because it exists. The manuscript also depicts 18th century London as the diverse landscape it actually was. It combats the whitewashing of history by not only openly acknowledging the fact that diasporic BIPOC folks existed and were persecuted, but also that the systems of power in play were due to racism and London's participation in racialization and the slave trade. And that adds to why gatekeepers see this kind of manuscript as a threat, because they don't want people to know the truth, and because they know the kind of power it has for people to know that folks have always existed subversively outside of the rules and the norms. So in the same way that Jack, as a jailbreaker and thief, is reclaiming the things that society claims he can't have, such as his own freedom and his own life, Dr. Voth is also reclaiming this manuscript for the people who need it. And in a larger sense, the story is really about how our existence, especially as marginalized people, is both because of history and also a creation of history in the process. By learning our history and sharing our history, we are adding to our history. And the best example of that is how you're reading Jack's story, but by definition, Dr. Voth is making that history new by adding his annotations and notes. He is creating new forms of context and understanding while also living his life as a trans person. And by recontextualizing the manuscript through his own lens, he's not changing the content of it, but he's also becoming a part of it. I'm not gonna lie, there were some times towards the end where I was like, what's going on? Where is this going? What is happening? But by the end, the story hit me like a ton of bricks, and it was so unlike any other reading experience in a way that I can't fully express. I wouldn't say it's perfect, and I certainly wouldn't say it's for everyone, but this book still got me real good by the end, and I gave it 4.5 stars. So those are all the queer books I read in June. Overall, it was a pretty good reading month, and I'm really excited to see what July brings. If you've read any of these books yourself, or if you plan to, feel free to leave your thoughts in a comment down below. But that's everything I had for this wrap-up today. Thank you so much for watching, and until next time, educate yourself, be kind to yourself, take care of yourself, and I will catch you on the flip side of the page.